So welcome to the Demography Today lecture series, sponsored by the BBVA Foundation and organized with the Spanish National Research Council and the Horizon 2020 LOMPOP project. Within our project, we have quite a lot of interest on the analysis of big data, epidemiology, and models in general. And we are very lucky today to have here José Javier de Ramasco, who is a distinguished researcher at the Spanish National Research Council. And he is working in the Institute for Cross-Disciplinary Physics and Complex Systems in the Palma de Mallorca, Balearic Islands, which is a center, a mixed center between the Spanish National Research Council and the University of the Balearic Islands. He is an elected member of the board of the Complex Systems Society and of the steering committee for the Conference of Complex Systems, the major global event in this area. He has a PhD in physics at the University of Cantabria in Santander in 2002, and he then had two postdoctoral positions at the University of Porto in Portugal and Emory University in Atlanta. And then he was working for 4 years at the EC Foundation in Turin, Italy. He has a lot of interest in modeling different kind of data, big data, epidemiological data, and just to work with the applications of this data for the analysis of real life. So thank you very much for accepting our invitation to come here to talk about these topics. And as usual, we have a 1 hour talk, between around 1 hour, and then we open the floor for questions.
Okay, so, well, what I'm going to show you now is a sort of a kind of a tour de force from modeling epidemics. What Diego was telling me is that actually previously in this series of presentations, there were already some people thinking about the utility of this kind of modeling. So I will try to convince you, or at least to put on the table, that actually this has some utility. Of course, I mean, you might deal with uncertainty in all these models. So essentially, the kind of scenarios that you are going to predict must have some kind of error bars, usually big error bars, no? So, but a priori, they can also give you some information about how the diseases are going to proceed and how they are going to spread. And this also, I mean, this is something that is something very, very valuable for people that can take decisions on public health, because it's a way to predict where things can happen or where there can be some needs. Like, for instance, medicines, hospital beds, and so on. No? And I wanted to present two particular cases, because actually this is something that is are cases that are ingrained in the mind of epidemiologists, and this can also bring like reactions to what is happening that can be, I mean, as you will see later for the example of the influenza in 2009. One of these examples actually was producing an effect also on the people that was supposed to take the decisions on the public health, because of the similarities that it has with this particular case. No? But well, the first one, and this essentially is the gold standard in this area, is this case of the Black Plague. This is a relatively ancient disease, I mean, because this happens in the 1300s. And well, it's caused by these elements here that are some sort of bacteria. And this bacteria has a life cycle that goes through different species. Actually, the humans are only one part of the full story. No? Actually, the killer element in here is not humans, but is this rat. So I couldn't resist to put this small icon, because those are actually the one to blame for a huge mortality in Europe during these times. No? Actually, this has a big impact, because I mean, all of a sudden, in a few years, 3-4 years, as I will show you later in one of the next slides, it killed almost 40%, between 30 and 50% of the population of Europe. Okay, so it was something that in a few years, all of a sudden, the population of cities decreases to almost one half in some places. And of course, it has a huge impact in the mentality of the people, in the way that people saw life, no? Because, I mean, for instance, there was a strong tendency towards religion themes and also towards this kind of pictures where you have the dance of the death, which is essentially something like saying that we are passing by, and I mean, it's a matter of luck that you can continue living or not in a matter of a few moments. No? The progression of this disease was very interesting because essentially it's a map of how the mobility of the time was when this happens. The first cases, I mean, as I was telling you, the disease is passing from different species, no? So essentially, it's usually endemic in rodents like prairie dogs and this kind of animals, like in Spanish it's called marmotas, is this kind of animals that are in the mountains, and it's endemic in two places now. One is in America, in North America, and the other one is in the prairies of Siberia, and the area between Russia and China. And then what happens here is that there was it was the time in which there was the invasions of the Mongols that came from the area of Siberia. So essentially they were attacking this point here that is called Kaffa. It was a small harbor in Crimea. And they started to suffer mortality. So essentially some people started to die out of the disease. So essentially in the siege, the Mongols took the body of these people and launched it to the city. This started to produce cases within the city. And then after that, some boats came out of Kaffa and moved towards Constantinople, with the first cases start to break down in there. Actually, the colors here are representing the years in which the disease start to appear. And actually, from there, it moves through the Mediterranean to Alexandria, to Venice, and to Genoa and Marseille, which are the main harbors in the time. And it enters, actually the first case in Spain or the Spanish land was in Mallorca, in the island of Mallorca. And after that, it passed to Valencia, and Barcelona, and occupied all of Europe. Actually, there were only a few cases of Europe or areas in Europe that were not affected by the disease. And it's a full mystery of why, and actually, I mean, which, what happens there, no? So one is around Milan, and the other one is in the area of Poland. Well, I mean, this killed a lot of people, as I was telling you, and among them, the most famous is this guy over here, which is Alfonso XI of Castile, that was sieging Gibraltar at the time, and then the disease came to the military camp, and people started to die, and one of them was the king. So essentially, this stopped the siege of Gibraltar for the time. What happens now? Well, I mean, because everybody thinks, well, I mean, this is something from the very old past, and this is, we have overcome this disease. Well, not fully. So it's true that now we have the medicines and essentially antibiotics, because these are bacteria, to handle this and to treat it. But the disease has not disappeared, and it continues to be endemic in these sort of animals, in these rodents. This is a paper recent in PLOS Medicine, and as you see over there in red, these are the countries where still have endemic cases of the disease between the rodents. I mean, luckily, I mean, there are some contagions to humans, but now the human-to-human contagion is much more constrained due to the medicine. The process, I mean, later it was discovered that actually is much more complicated, because it goes in the rodents, the fleas are the ones that essentially take the care of passing it to humans and pass it to other kind of animals. But there is also the involvement of falcons, cats, and also camels that can, do the role of vectors to transmit the disease through the fleas. No? The fleas pass from one animal to the other and can actually pass the bacteria. The other case that is interesting, and this is the one that I was telling you that is very important, because, I mean, the lessons that were learned in this case were also incorporated in the reaction that the authorities have to the 2009 epidemic of flu. So is this this one of the so-called Spanish flu of 1918. So actually, the process was also kind of dramatic. This is a virus, because this is a type of flu that is actually is close related to the one that happens in the 2009, because the type is similar, it's H1N1. And the particularity of this is that it occurred in a population that was not protected against this kind of viruses, and it killed a lot of people. Also, the mortality is around 30%, more or less. And it has the particularity that, well, it was the time also of the First World War. So essentially in the countries that were involved in the conflict didn't want to say that there was some problem of high mortality. So it started to introduce, I mean, they started to introduce measures to try to control it, but also at the same time, they also controlled the press to maintain the new out of the view of the general public. And the name of Spanish flu comes from the fact that actually Spain was a neutral country in the conflict. And it was the first cases in which the press started to inform about strange cases of mortality due to influenza. Well, I mean, the particularity of this disease is that there were three peaks. The first one was relatively mild and actually not so deadly. And the second one was there was one in numbers and also in causality. The other particularity is that it was affecting a population that was completely unprotected to these sort of viruses. So it produced a mortality that is a little different from the normal curve of seasonal influenza. I mean, the seasonal influenza, as you have in this dashed line over there, what you have is that the mortality is usually concentrated in old people and young people, no? So those that are not so strongly defended by the immunity system to against the virus. But in the case of the 1918 influenza, there was also a peak in the middle, and the middle means people like 25, 24, and this was due to the very strong reaction of the immune system. Essentially, what was happening was that the virus was entering into the body, all the way to the lungs, and then the strong reaction of the immune system was producing a sort of huge allergic, I mean, quotation marks, eh? It's not like allergic reaction, but essentially the immune system was the one taking care of trying to eradicate the virus out of the lungs, but also killing the individual. No? Okay, so this is something interesting because this happened also in some cases in Mexico in the 2009 influenza, and this also triggered many of the alarms. And what happens with this one? Well, I mean, there is still controversy about where it was coming from, but there is a sort of picture that has emerged, and is the idea is that it could start somewhere in the South US, so in the area of Kansas, and then it passes to the, I mean, this was the time that the American army was essentially concentrating people to send it to Europe, because of course they were involved in the war effort. So it passed to some of these military camps, and actually they are the first documentation about mortality and about the influenza referring to this sort of camps. And actually the photo that I was showing you is one of those military camps on that time. And actually from there it was coming to the military camps that the Allies have in the north of France, and then from there it distributed through Europe. And then to the rest of the world. Okay, so this is the two examples that I wanted to show you, and especially the second one because this marks a reference to what happened later may happen also if there is a new pandemic of influenza. No? Well, the important thing there is in all these things is this is, I mean, let's say the natural environment by itself, so what happens out there with the diseases and the infectious diseases, especially this one of contacts. And then the question is how we model this. Well, I mean, going back towards the origin, the first model on this on this sort of things of epidemiology is usually assigned to this person, which is Daniel Bernoulli. And what he proposed, I mean, that time the important thing was the smallpox. And there was a big controversy about vaccination. Essentially, it seems that after 200 years, we still keep, or 300 years, we still keep talking about this. No? But the idea at the time was a little more justified because actually the vaccine was not so safe in the sense that they didn't do anything to the strains directly or to the pathogens directly, and they just injected to another person. Supposedly it was some sort of, they were not producing it directly from the body of people that had the disease, but actually from the part that was already rejecting it. But even so, the mortality for people that was vaccinated was not absolutely zero. Okay, so it was not very small. And actually, the discussion was: is it worthy to vaccinate or not? I mean, because I mean, a priori, it's important to decide if by putting the vaccines you are killing more people than by the disease itself, no? And then what Daniel Bernoulli did, because actually the question is that the casualty, if it happens by smallpox, it can be at any age, no? So it's not necessarily, like for instance, the vaccination, you can say, okay, we are going to vaccinate all the babies of a certain amount. Okay, I mean, then if it happens there, and if there is a mortality because of the vaccine, it will happen in that part of the timeline of the life of the persons. But the question that he was trying to answer is, okay, I mean, it's true that if they are vaccinated at, let's say, 3 months of age, at 3 months of age, there will be some casualties because of the vaccine. But then what happens if we count all of those that will die because of lack of vaccination along their lives, no? And then he wrote these equations, actually a set of equations, where the important thing for him was the S, which is the susceptible people at a certain age. So essentially, how many of these people can actually catch the disease at the different ages. And then out of that, the other part that is important is the probability of being infected at this age and the probability of dying out of the infection. Okay, so if you catch the infection, how many of them will die? And then what he did was to do the calculation. I mean, you can solve this equation. And then he produced this, this curve comes from a paper now, but he produced some tables showing which was the people that will die out of the disease if there was nothing, I mean, nothing was done, if there was no vaccination, and also the people that will save, actually, by the fact that you vaccinate, everybody, you know, let's say at a certain age when they are babies. And this is more or less illustrated in this curve by plotting how many people is still alive with and without the disease. Okay, so because he was assuming that if you were vaccinated and you didn't die in the first a few days out of the effect of the vaccination, you will continue living, but of course dying of other causes because that are still there, no? And this is why, I mean, this curve when the age is very, very high, touch one another, no? The question in there is that what he found is that actually you need to have a huge causality rate in the vaccination to make it unpractical, let's say, no? And actually, it is, he says something like, even if there was a 10% causality rate out of the vaccination, it would be still worth it to vaccinate. This would be the middle point. So essentially, if the vaccination mortality was higher than this, it would not be practical. In practice, it was much lower than this. I mean, he was talking in the paper about 1 out of 200 in mortality at the time, and we are talking about the 1700s. So a priori, what he was concluding out of his paper, it was worthy vaccinating people. And later, I mean, of course, this progresses and more vaccination appear. No? The second step, I mean, actually, this model already have many, many of the elements that are now in the models today. But the second big step was taken by these two people, McHenry and Carmack. And these are already 1927, okay? So the idea here that they have is, like, I mean, how should we do the modeling of diseases? It was going into this question of the compartmental models, no? So the idea is, okay, we are going to divide the population in those that are susceptible, as Bernoulli did, and then those that are infectious or infected, those that are, in this case of the model that they propose, like has this remove part of the population, those that are already that they are already healed, so they are not infectious anymore, and usually they are protected against the disease from that moment on. No? So, or they die and then they are not able to propagate anymore the disease. So for that, they propose this model called SIR with the three compartments, and then they produce with it the first epidemic curves, like this one, that were matching. Actually, what was happening in one epidemic, this one was done the circles, the open circles are from an epidemic in Calcutta, and then the curve is their fit to the epidemic curve. The idea of these epidemic curves, this is the incidence, so essentially the number of cases, and those are in the x-axis you have the time, is that they also always have this kind of shape. So essentially at the beginning you have a very strong increase, which is usually exponential, And after that, as the number of us or the fraction of susceptible start to disappear out of the population because many people has already contracted the disease, they start to decay, and the decay is also relatively fast. Okay. Well, this is in the modeling side, and then you can say, okay, what has happened? You have just jumped 200 years, no? Well, in the middle, there were some other things, and then one of the things are very interesting because it was about data. This happens in London. It was done by this guy, John Snow, and this was an epidemic of cholera in 1854. What happens in there was that, cholera usually occurs because of polluted waters, and what he was doing was to take a map and to start to mark the places where these cases were found, and also in time, let's say. No? So he was kind of trying to understand if there was some sort of center of this thing, because it would be the point to look at the spring or the water resource that you have there to try to find if actually it was the cause of the propagation. And actually, this is what he did, and he found the likely place, and after this solved more or less the epidemic of this time. Okay, so then what has happened after that? We have looked at some models that were more or less equations. These equations essentially assume that everybody can infect to everybody else. Any infected can infect to anybody else in the population. And then we have seen that there are some people that take data in a painful way and then put the plots on the maps. Okay, so, the things have evolved a lot, of course, in the last 100 years. And they have evolved in two ways. The conceptual tools for the models are there, and actually were proposed by these people that already introduced models like SIR. But then the difference is that now we have the computers, and we can use those models deeply. We can do simulations with everything, inside the computers. The other one is that actually the computers can also facilitate the handling of data. And instead of having to plot by hand where the cases is happening, you can just plot it in a computer very, very fast. So essentially, the mix of the two things, no? So epidemics and computers, is the big changes that has been happening in the last decade, more or less. For that, there is the question of forecasting. And I know that this can be a little delicate, but since I am, my background is from physics, what we did was just to search for a situation where there is forecasting that more or less works, okay? And to think that we want to produce something like this. This is a weather forecast, and as everybody knows, what happens is that you have someone saying on the TV, tomorrow is going to rain, tomorrow is going to be this temperature, tomorrow is going to be this wind. And of course there are mistakes, because sometimes they say it's going to rain and there is no rain. So there is a chance of getting it right, and there is also a chance of getting it, of failing, let's say, in the prediction. No? And this is, for instance, what is over there. In that site, what you have is the location of a hurricane, okay? This is typically from in the southern state of the US, and for instance, when I was living in Atlanta, this was something that you have to look at from time to time because your security was with it. So the idea is that when you see this kind of predictions, what they do is to show you where is the hurricane and also a cone. The cone is the cone of uncertainty. So it can, after 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, it can be in any place of this cone. The center of the hurricane. Eh? The hurricanes are usually very big, so essentially that means that for a few hundred kilometers you can miss it, but depending of if you are not on that cone, you must take some measures, and if actually you are in the very center of the trajectory, probably you should take it. So the idea is, okay, this is the way that is done when you have uncertainty, in this case because of this is a very highly chaotic system and high-dimensional chaotic system. And then the problem of uncertainty is coming from the fact that you don't know exactly the situation of the system in that moment. Then there is non-linear equations that are the ones that say how the weather is going to behave. And then small differences in the initial conditions transform into big differences after a while. So essentially, what you can do, or the best that you can do, is to run it many, many times and say, okay, out of all this, changing very, very little the initial conditions, this is the area that could affect, or this is the way that the system can evolve. In the case of epidemics, it's a little more complicated, but the ideas will be the same. So essentially, what you need is the information about how the disease behaves. So essentially, the life cycle of the disease somehow, no? As we were talking about the black plague. In that case, it was the fleas, rodents, humans. In the case of the flu, it's simpler because it's human to human. So essentially what we need is to know how it affects to the humans. And then the next thing that you need is the initial conditions. And in this case, the initial conditions refer to the place where the disease started. And after that, the idea of doing forecasting is like this. You say, okay, I run my model. I try to predict where it's going to be in time. And also, I mean, of course, I have to admit that there are things that I know. Like, for instance, there are parts of infectivity that they are unknown, or there can be questions on the disease that may not be controllable by simple models. But a priori, I mean, you can complicate the model if you need. I mean, like, I will show you some examples later of models that can be more or less complicated. But the question is that always, in all cases, you are going to have that uncertainty, because, I mean, there are things that you cannot control in models. Like, for instance, if people get scared and move from one place to another, they bring the disease with them. And of course, I mean, this is something that a priori in your models you don't put. You can modify the models to have this into account, but it will be impossible to control everything. So essentially what you can say is, okay, the disease is likely to be here in this time, and this is the uncertainty rate. So essentially you have to put always a window of uncertainty. To start to do these kind of models, and as I was telling you, there are many, many realistic models, these questions, I mean, connect to mobility, as you will show next, because actually what I'm going to show you now is the kind of chronological order, the efforts that were done for this sort of modeling. No? The first one comes from Los Alamos, that is also a laboratory for nuclear bombs and this kind of thing. Actually, the nuclear bomb was created here. And these people have huge computers, and the idea that they have was, I mean, not related to epidemics at this moment, it was in 1998, but they wanted to generate what they call synthetic societies. So they wanted to produce, I mean, for instance, they also did a model about stock markets and the evolution of stock markets by design, let's say, no, in the computer. And the other one was this one about transport. It's called Transim. And this is still in use now. I mean, what they did was just to take a city, all the possible transportation media, and then what they wanted to understand was the demand and how the demand could evolve if you do things like adding a new line or changing the directions of the streets or these kind of questions. I mean, these are very helpful for, let's say, decision makers or the mayor or the people that has to change or to control the transportation system of the city. No? The question is that, of course, when you see something like this, this is based on the idea of having everybody in the computer, not saying, okay, I have this city, the city has 2 million people, I put 2 million agents in my computer. This is what these models are called agent-based. And then for everybody of them, I say, okay, according to the census, you live in this area, and then you go to work in this other area. So essentially, I add the mobility of the homework, and sometimes you have to take into account that there can be some other mobility, let's say, no, in there. But at least in the census, you have the homework relatively well characterized. And what you do in your model, in your simulation, is to run the thing like these persons were moving and from home to work and checking, I mean, which are the possibilities or the best choices for doing the transportation. Okay, so this is the sort of models that were out in the market at the end of the 90s. And then the first use for epidemics was this one, EpiSims, that actually was also produced by people working in Los Alamos. And the idea here was, okay, I mean, we have the mobility, even if it is in a design model, and then we're going to put some infected guy, and let's see if how this propagates according to the mobility patterns that we see here. They put, actually, one of the first things that they put was the flu, and of course, then the question is, because the flu is what is called a contact disease, so essentially it is airborne propagated. So essentially, if you are in a room close with people and one of them has the disease, the other ones have some probability of getting it. No? And then the important question for this was where people concentrated. So essentially like malls, theaters, and later it was seen that mostly schools and kindergarten, because essentially the younger people and children are the ones that usually act as more active to pass the disease. In this first case, I mean, what they did was just to study how it will propagate in Portland. This is the city over there. And they did some simulations and actually check how was the effect of the big concentration centers for the propagation of the disease. After this, because it's 2004, so essentially to now, 13 years, there has been a lot of models, so essentially full countries, full areas, full geographical things. Because of course, I mean, think that in computers today, you can easily put millions of agents. I mean, it's not a matter of just staying with a city of 2 million. You can put easily 40 million, and then you have full country like Spain. Or you can put 500 million, and then you have the full Europe. This is a case for 2005 publication in Nature about the evaluation of how the epidemic of flu will propagate in the Southeast Asia. Then you have a lot of work actually for the US. This is 2010. And then there is also works, like for instance this one in 2009, and some other more recent, up to now, I mean, let's say until 2016, on agent-based simulation in Europe. Okay, and then, well, I mean, if you are talking about this kind of models, you can say, well, yes, I mean, you have everybody in the computer, everything is there, everything is wonderful, you control everything, and then, of course, you are able to predict, as I was telling you, with uncertainties, no? And, well, where is the uncertainties coming from? Well, from the fact that you don't control everything, the people can react in ways that you don't have predicted, but not only on that, also on the fact that you, I mean, when you introduce in the model, you live here and you work there, this is an assumption that comes from census data. And the census data is not telling you where you exactly live and where you exactly work. I mean, the people from the census office collect this information, but then they cannot make it publicly available for natural reasons. I mean, there is a privacy after all, no? So the question is that many of these models make assumptions about how many people live in a certain area and how many people of those work in another area. Like for instance, you say, okay, I'm going to make a household by design, no? So let's say I take a house in a certain part of the city. According to the census, the average household in this city is of this size, then I put inside, like for instance, three people. So let's say the father, the mother, and a child. But these are assumptions after assumptions. So essentially, yes, they correspond to the census on average, but you don't know if actually this is the truth. And when you are saying that the children go to a certain school because it's the closest to the house, this is again another assumption. And when you do all this, the model, of course, I mean, at a certain point, are going to react in a similar way to reality, but it's not necessarily exactly what it will happen. No? So this is a way to do it. And then I'm going to show you another way that actually is older than agent-based modeling, but that we have developed in the last years and that doesn't need so much information. Okay, so this is a kind of a different approach to the problem. If you want, this is a physics approach. So essentially, going towards the spheric cow approach, which is the typical one for physicists, we are going to assume that we don't need to know exactly what happens in every area. Okay, so we are going to use a concept that comes from ecology, that's called metapopulations. And then within a population, we are going to assume that there are some contacts between the people locally, and thus they can pass the disease one to another. And then the only thing that we will need to know for how the disease propagates within these populations is which is the probability of someone to pass the disease to another one. Essentially, so if there is a contact between an infected and a susceptible, which is the probability of the susceptible to catch the disease. And this is an average, okay? So this includes all the sort of local interactions because this will go through a social network if it is a disease that has to be transmitted by close proximity, or it can be something like you are in the same place like happens with the influenza. Okay, so this, I mean, the real one is a very intricate network, but you are assuming that all those connections, all those contacts can be modeled by a single parameter, that is, which is the probability of infecting another one in the same area. And then once you have that, this is what happens in one of these populations, or metapopulation if you want. The important thing is how people go from one to another, okay? Because in those that move from one to another are the ones that will move with the infection, and actually are the ones that will bring the infectious disease from one population to another. And for that, I mean, at this level of information, this is much better control, and you don't have to do so many assumptions. I mean, of course, you have to assume that you are able to treat this kind of probability of infection, which is an effective parameter, okay? But out of that, there is no more assumptions because, like for instance, this one, is the, I mean, we build the model, and then this, in this one, what you have is the first, the basic layer of the model, which is essentially the population. And then, since the important things are populations and how people move across them, the main transportation centers are very, very important. And these are the ones that are in red spots here. These are the airports. Okay, so what we do in, to build this model is, okay, we have the populations. The populations are in relatively small, very small cells, and actually they are coming from census and from satellite data, because, I mean, there is a project that essentially all over the world are associating light intensity with the population that is in the different areas. And this allows you to have a very detailed, I mean, high resolution distribution of population. And then what you do is to associate those populations to the nearest airport. Okay, and this essentially defines some sort of basins around the airports. And then what you need to do after that is, as I was telling you, I mean, you are going to assume that within these basins, there are a certain chance of someone to pass the disease to one another. And then after that, you need to include the transportation between the different basins. The transportation at the level of airports is up there in the case of the US. And what you have down is the ground transportation. And since these are only between basins, this is relatively coarse grain, let's say. So you don't need to have things at the level of a few meters, because I mean the model. This model was built to study the propagation of diseases at the global way. I mean at the global level. So we are talking about the full Earth. So we are not so much interested in a certain neighborhood of a city or not. No? But at this level, I mean these are the sort of things that you have, and you have the data. I mean, in fact, if you go to the census. You can find data. I mean, we found at the time, this was 2009, data in 30, actually there is 29 there, but it was 30 at the end when we finished the publication countries. And these countries were all over the place except in Africa. Africa was the hardest place to find the information about this. And with that, you could build a big network about mobility on the ground transportation. The one of the air is all registered, so essentially that's much easier. You can get this data. Season by because there are two agents that are involved in the air transportation that have this data. On the one side you have the airlines, and on the other side you have like the ones that are selling the tickets. And of course, everybody has this kind of everybody. There are some some companies or some associations that have this data, and you can access it. This is the difficult thing is the ground transportation, and for that we needed this kind of census information. And now, I mean, in the last few years, this can also be obtained from big data analysis. So essentially, mobile phone records, online social networks like Twitter. So essentially, this kind of information can be obtained from more and more sources. Okay, so in this case, we have 30 countries, and then we needed the rest. I mean, of course, because if we want to build a model for everything in the world, you need to include the rest. What we did, I mean, we went back again to the information that you can get from transportation literature. And actually, they are using this sort of equations to model the demand of transport in the different areas. This is called gravity law. And what you have there is the flux of people that will move from one area to another. And then what you have on the other side is the populations of the origin area and the destination area. And then also the distance between these areas, because this is supposed to decay with the distance. What we did was to test the data that we have with this sort of equations, and we went a fit for the different areas. So essentially, you have the dependence with the distance, dependence with the destination population, and dependence with the origin destination. Of course, with big error bars, because I mean this is a lot of empirical data, and there are many things there that can affect the results. But in general, we managed to obtain a relatively consistent picture of what can be done with this sort of gravity laws. And then after applying it to the data set, we also applied it to some of the countries. When you see that the points are more or less aligned in a flat line, the model is predicting well what we see in the data. And then the gray areas are the uncertainty. So essentially, sometimes we fail in the prediction of the model. But once we have that, you can say, well, I have all the ingredients. So essentially, we have the population and the transportation centers, the ground transportation, and the air transportation. Okay, so this is the three ingredients that are basic to the model of epidemics. And then the last one is the one of the disease. For the disease, what you need to know is essentially which are all the paths that we are saying about compartments. No? So essentially, you need to know how the susceptibles pass to infected, the infected pass to remove, and which kind of things you can have in there. And maybe I have, okay, it's here. Okay, this is an example of what is this this model for influenza. Okay, so in here, what we have is the susceptibles on the top, that if they get in contact with one of the infected possibilities, they can be infected. Then the influenza has the particularity that for a relatively short period of time, you are latent. So essentially, you have the disease in your body, but you are not still showing symptoms. This is usually one day approximately, okay? And then after that, this incubation period, you start to show symptoms or not. Because there are actually, by default, there are three types of people. So essentially the ones that have very strong symptoms. And usually they don't travel, they stay at home, at bed, and taking medicines if they need to. They're the ones that are infected, so, some symptoms, but they are still traveling and moving, okay? And this is important because they can propagate the disease to other places. And then there are the ones that are asymptomatic. Asymptomatic means that or they don't show any symptom, or they show symptoms like a cold. So essentially they sneeze and they cough, but they are not feeling so bad as to do anything, so essentially they are moving normally. Depending on the severity of the symptoms, the infectiousness of the disease is a little higher or lower. So essentially, in this model, we have to take into account that the asymptomatic can infect other people, but in a very slower rate compared with the people that are symptomatic. And well, the infected non-traveling, they are usually not, I mean, infecting only local people, I mean, people around their home residents. And then once you have all these parameters, I mean, as you see, there are different rates here, I mean, from passing from one state to another. Many of them can be filled directly from clinical records. Like, for instance, the time to recovery, this move over here is the time to go from infected to recover. And this is something that, in many of the cases of influenza, is relatively well known, because you can look at it in the clinical records. There is also the question of how many of the people goes to the different states. And this is also relatively known, I mean, but with a lot of uncertainty again, but there is a certain records on the hospitals and the clinical records. So essentially you have an idea of which are these values. And then the one that is very hard to know is the infectivity, the parameter beta that is over there, because this is the probability of infecting another person when you are in the population. Remember that this is the most dangerous, the most difficult thing to measure, okay? Well, with this ready, and let's say with the global model ready, we were preparing the paper just to send it to the publication, when all of a sudden there was this thing coming out. So this was 2009, and there was a pandemic. And this is something that was a matter of luck, so we were not preparing anything like that, but it was actually handy somehow, no? In the sense that we have the model, we have everything ready, and all of a sudden in the news they start to say, ah, there is something strange, there is something strange happening in Mexico. And this something strange was a new type of influenza, it's a new strain. And when this happens, usually the whole thing propagates from the place where it was detected for the first time towards the rest of the world. And this particular case, I mean, in this particular case, the 2009 pandemic started in a small place called La Gloria, that is in close to Mexico City. And it passed from pigs to humans. And then this is exactly the same path that the 1918 influenza is, the more or less the same type. I mean, because it's also similar in the shape of the virus. And then the thing started to move in Mexico. This was February, more or less, where the first cases are detected. And the nice thing of this is that actually, for the very first time, it was really, really tracked from the very beginning. So essentially, it's more or less known which are the first cases and how it was propagating from this small place to another cities in Mexico till reaching Mexico City. Then at the same time, this produced, I mean, as I was telling you, the people that is managing the public health essentially are acting according to what they know, and this case start to resemble a lot the situation in the 1918. Also because when these first cases were essentially detected in Mexico, for that time they started to appear in the news. In the hospitals, of course, the people that was, let's say, in worse conditions were going there. And then the mortality was relatively high of those that were going to the hospitals. I mean, because there were a lot of people that was not going to the hospital because, I mean, the symptoms were not for that. But if you divide the number of cases registered in the hospital by the number of casualties, you take a very bad surprise because it was a very high number. No? So essentially, all the pieces started to enter into the puzzle. And then, of course, it did trigger a huge media attention. And it has, I mean, actually a good side because this media attention allowed to track the very first cases in all detail. So essentially the very first cases in the other countries, let's say, not Mexico. And this essentially allowed to do a fitting of this famous beta parameter, the parameter of infectivity. Because when you have you have the dates of arrival of the first cases to the different countries, what you can take is you take your model, you run it, and then you say, okay, let's assume different values of the infectivity parameter, and let's check if this will or not match with the observation dates of arrivals. Then the model that most likely produced the certain infectivity that most likely reproduces this sort of propagation pattern is the most likely, I mean, this is a maximum likelihood approach, is the most likely to do it, and then you can assign a certain value to the infectivity with error bars again. Yeah? So remember that everything here had error bars. And then with that, you can actually do a simulation and run it. And these, for instance, are simulations from the model in the model in Europe. At the beginning, there were two scenarios here. I mean, these simulations were done at the beginning of middle of May, more or less. Okay, this I mean, the first cases were in February. The first ones in the media were mid April, so 16th of April. Actually, it was the first press release about the disease, and then this was done 15 days later. Okay, so it was very, very fast. And then what we are seeing there is two scenarios: one without doing anything in how it will propagate in Europe, and the other one with antivirals. I mean, providing antivirals massively to the population. And then what you are seeing there is that, I mean, what could be expected, no? Essentially, since the disease originated in Mexico, the first places that appear in Europe was Madrid, something in London. And then out of that, it was evolving in the continent and producing a relatively big in the two scenarios. The big difference between using massively antivirals and not doing it is over there, down there, that there is the two curves, the two epidemic curves. And actually, what we are talking is about a few weeks of delay in the peak of the disease. So essentially, the question was, is this worthy or not to do this kind of measure? A priori, I mean, the answer depends on the mortality. No? So if actually we are talking about the Black Plague or the 1918, probably yes. It should be, I mean, you can gain some time to actually develop the vaccine, but this time is not enough, actually, because for the vaccine you need a few months. So essentially what you will get this is to buy some time, but I mean, the cost of using massively antivirals, so essentially it was not a very realistic scenario. But it was something that should be tested because it's something that when the public authorities see it, they can take decisions based on this kind of plots. And actually, this one was passed to the European Commission, and similar one was passed to the American authorities at the time. Okay, so, and you can say, I mean, this comes back to the question of, yeah, you are modeling, you produce different results, different scenarios, and then you put it in front of a politician that has to take decisions. So it's not dangerous, I mean, you are doing it right or not. Well, I mean, this is the work of the scientists. I mean, one thing is that what you do in the moment, of, let's say, panic moment of the disease, and the other one is once the whole thing was over, the important thing was to collect the data that you could get and compare the predictions of your model with the predictions of, I mean, with what really happened, and to see how much trustable the models are, okay? Because this is not just forecasting by forecasting. It's a question of trying to make sure that actually what you are doing is well-grounded. And this is what we did in here. I mean, we collected data. These are the different countries. Then in the heat map in red, you have the peaks of the disease. And then in gray, with the error bars due to the different uncertainties that we have, the prediction of the model. And as you can see, in many of these, we are more or less doing well. And then there are some that we are not doing so well because, of course, I mean, we cannot promise that we are, I mean, this is not a magic thing. This is mathematics. So essentially, mathematics with a lot of uncertainty. So sometimes you don't get it right. And there are several countries where we did very bad, very badly. For instance, one was France. This was a sort of surprise. So we still don't have a clear explanation of why. Then there were other countries like, for instance, Switzerland, Hungary, that are relatively small countries. And what was happening in there was that the information that we were lacking was the one that was very, very important to do the predictions on those countries. It was the ground transportation between countries. Okay, we have in some parts, like for instance in the US, between US and Mexico, we introduced the data that we could find about mobility between ground transportation between the two countries, and also with Canada. But we were not able to find similar data in Europe at the time. So essentially, the small countries of Europe, like Hungary or Switzerland, where you have a very strong component of ground transportation, of course, we are appearing more isolated in the model than what they are in reality. And this is why the epidemic arrived earlier than what we were predicting. And the model is not doing it right. And then the other countries that we had problems was the big countries that have that cover a lot of space in latitude, especially, because the disease has the influenza has a particularity that is that it behaves differently in summer and in winter. There are different cases, different reasons why. One is from physical origin, so the question of the high temperature and humidity that can discourage or help the propagation of the virus. And then the other one is from social origin, the fact that if it is cold and rainy, you are going to go inside, and then it's more likely that the disease propagates. So essentially, this affects the infectivity parameter. And then in the model, we were considering like north, equator, and south, let's say, and affecting the infectivity parameter in the north and the south in opposite ways, essentially in a sinusoidal correction. And these sort of things in countries that goes all the way from the equator to the tropics is not working so well, because by simplification, we were taking a kind of strict boundary where the infectivity was affected and where it was not. And it is not true because it is a continuum. No? So essentially the model should be more elaborated. And this is what we were finding, that essentially if we split those countries in pieces, we are getting it much better than if we were doing in a full country. So then the other thing that we could do once we had the model was to compare the two approximations. This is a comparison, in this case in Italy, of the disease with the model of metapopulation and with an agent-based model. Okay, so essentially those ones that I was talking at the beginning, that you are just simulating every element in the population or a big fraction of them. And then in this kind of models, in the agent-based model, what you have is much more detailed. You have age, gender, where they live, where they work, if they go to schools, and so on. No? And then to make it in a similar way, what we did was just to use the global model for running the epidemic from the source, and then assuming that every time that we find the data that, an individual that was arriving at Italy, we were passing this information both to the two models, to the model of a metapopulation and to the agent-based model that was using this information as an income. Okay, so for them, the initial conditions were every case entering it into Italy. And then after that, we ran the two models, and then we compared the results. And this is what we did in here. So in black, you have the metapopulation model, and in red, the agent-based model. What happens here is there is a difference of around 10% on the number of cases in the peak between the two. So because this is essentially due to the fact that the agent-based model has a much more well-structured population. You start to have information about who contact with whom, age and separation by work and workplace and all these kind of questions. So essentially, this introduces more details and make more difficult the propagation of the disease. Okay, in the other one, we are assuming that everybody that is in the same population can or have some chance to affect to the others. And this is why there is this small difference. But then the other thing is that the timing on the peaks in general, or more than the peaks, the beginning of the outbreak were relatively similar, and actually this is something that was giving us confidence in the sense that if you are trying to model the timing, any of the two approaches are good enough. If you are trying to model the cases, you have to be careful if you use a metapopulation, because you have to put some correction in the picture. And then other thing that we did was just to analyze what will happen if you say, nobody wants to go to the place where the disease is. So essentially, the air transportation is going to fall. Okay, so you do that, and this happened actually in Mexico. There was a drop, a relatively big drop in the number of people traveling there when there was this big fuss on the news. Well, what you can wonder is, okay, which is going to be the delay in the propagation of the disease due to this this kind of effect? So if nobody goes there, there will be no, I mean, the delay will be infinite. There will be no propagation. But actually, I mean, it has to be almost nobody, because as long as there is a small fraction of people going, what you get is a delay of days in the propagation pattern. Okay, so for instance, in here, yeah, what you see in this first plot is what happens if you affect a 50% drop, 60, 70, 80, and 90% drop. And then as you see, you don't gain too much. So as I said, this kind of modeling also allows you to see if this kind of travel restriction are going to help you or not. And in this question of the flu, the reason why it doesn't work is because the latent people travels, so essentially, or even asymptomatic people travel. So that means that they are not detectable in the airports, and they will travel anyway because they are not feeling bad. So essentially, they will pass all controls, and then the whole thing will propagate. Okay, so then after that, just very, very kind of publicity, saying that actually these models are online, and people can use it if they want. This is the link over that down there. And actually, you can build the model that you want, because you are, I mean, as long as you put compartments and clarify which are going to be transitions of people from one side to another, you can build it and then run it and obtain things like this. I mean, you will run it online, let's say, no, because the database about mobility is in the servers of this place. And then you will obtain curves like that will be showing you what happens in every airport basin and how the disease will evolve with the different uncertainty that you can put in there. I mean, about the parameters of activity or the parameters of seasonality or the other things that you can put in there. Okay, so this is all the way to, let's say, 2014, 15. Okay, and now, let's say, what has been happening in the very, very last years? Well, there are two examples that I wanted to show you of what is happening right now, I mean, actually on this. And this is, of course, moved by what is called emerging diseases. So essentially, new diseases that show up in that public attention, or even not even the public attention, the WHO attention by itself. And then the question is, what can we say about those? There was, I mean, two cases that were very well known in the last 2 years. And this was one, or 3 years. One was Ebola in the north Western part of Africa, or Western part of Africa, actually, that, of course, was a deadly disease. And this was very particular. So I say modeling this disease with this kind of simple models is much harder. It can be done, mostly with AM base, because the transmission of this disease is relatively particular. It's not so easy. It's not airborne, most of it. I mean, most of what is happening is that people that is infected can start to sweat or to have different fluids, and then if you get in contact with them, is the way that you can catch the disease. But this is not something like you are in a room, you can infect everybody else. I mean, it will not be very safe to be in that situation, but the most likely thing is that if you don't touch the person, the chances of getting it is relatively small. And modeling this kind of contact is much harder than modeling the influenza or these kind of things. But there are something that you can already say. Like, for instance, this result over here was about the propagation of transmission of the disease to other countries. So in this case, I mean, careful, because they were not saying this is going to get out of Africa. No, I mean, a priori they didn't know, and actually it didn't get out of Africa more than in a few cases that were moved from Africa to the other countries. No? What they were doing here was to say, okay, if it gets very, I mean, the disease gets widely propagated into Africa, which are the most likely places it will go out of there, if it goes? I mean, this is the, if it goes, no? And then there were some chances to go to the different countries, and they could produce some sort of probability of getting infected out of the transportation patterns from Africa. And then the other one was to do, okay, I mean, if the transmission pattern of the disease is relatively complicated, let's do a complicated model. So let's use an agent-based model where we know most of the things about the agents, age, gender, where they are, where they work, and all these kind of things. And let's try to simulate what will happen with the disease and how it evolves. And this is what it was done in this other paper that was published in the Lancet Infectious Diseases. And well, after doing some fitting to the parameters of the disease, These are, for instance, the blue points over there. They try to do some extrapolations about how it will evolve. And this is what you have on the right side of the screen. So essentially the peak and the falling, and those are the dates that we were predicting that this could happen, depending on the measures that you will take. In this case, one of the main transmission factors was the burial of people with the disease, because, I mean, socially it was, I mean, they have a certain way of burying the people in there that was essentially facilitating the propagation of the disease. And this was if people stopped doing this kind of things or they didn't, no? And then these are the different scenarios that they were running. So this was a first thing. And then the other case that I wanted to show you, and with this we will finish, is the question of Zika. Zika has been also in the news relatively, I mean, last year. And the question is that this is a disease that goes through mosquitoes. So essentially the vector of transmission of the disease is mosquitoes. And when you are bitten by a mosquito, you can get the Zika. The Zika by itself is not so dangerous. I mean, typically it is something that produces symptoms similar to a flu. And after a few times, you will be more or less recovered. But it is dangerous for pregnant women because it can affect the fetus and produce malformations. That actually is the thing that brought it to the news. And then what, when you want to do a model of these kind of things, since there is another vector in the equation, it's not human to human. It's human, mosquito, and human, no? Let's say. And then you have to have into account the mosquitoes too. And this is the thing that is relatively difficult, because you have to have into account and to have information about the density of mosquitoes, how it evolves in time, and how it appears in the different areas that you want to model. And remember that these sort of models are great big scale. So essentially, we are talking about continents. So this is the kind of things that was done in this paper down there. And then what they did was just some predictions of the forecast, let's say, on the evolution of the disease in the different countries, and how it will affect most of America, let's say. And also they produce some tables taking into account the chances that these infected people will be pregnant women and the fraction of people, of pregnant women that are affected by that. I mean, the fetus are affected by this kind of things. So they can produce some tables actually saying how many cases could be expected on these things. Again, with big error bars. Eh? I mean, it's not... but it was interesting because they were giving the data country by country and also in time. So essentially you could have an idea of the number of cases that you could be seeing in this question. Okay, so this is more or less it. So, I mean, the question in here was to show you that, let's say, the aim here was to do forecast, as I was saying, like if it will be weather forecast, but with disease propagation. And, well, this needs, I mean, to do this and do it well, you need a lot of information. And the more information you have, the better will be the model, because you will reduce uncertainties, okay? But there is one piece of information that is essential, and this is mobility. So to actually do these kind of things, and especially to do it in a global scale, we need to know how people move and how many people goes from one place to another. And this has to be done at different scales. So this is why this was called a multi-level model, let's say, because you have the component of the air transportation, which is essentially country-country, or even within big countries, let's say. The component of ground transportation that is much more abundant, but I mean, it processes the information in shorter distances. And then you have to have also implementing of all that the information that you have about the disease. That in some cases, like, I mean, if we are talking about early cases like in the 2009 pandemic of influenza, it was patchy. So essentially we have information of what has been happening with seasonal influenza, what has happened in the classical or in the past pandemics. But actually there were things that were not there at the moment. I mean, when we did the simulation, and I was talking about May, we didn't know, for instance, that there was a cross immunity in the population and that almost 30% of the people was immune to the virus because there has been another strain passing through the population a few years, I mean, well, if you know some, I mean, like a few decades before. And actually these people was much harder to, I mean, they were not completely immune, but they were much harder to infect than what we had in the model. So essentially the propagation, the timing of the disease was well done. The number of cases was, I mean, there was this kind of mismatches because of that, of this kind of thing. So essentially this information is very important, and it's important to get it as soon as possible if you want to really do forecast that, is worthy. And then finally, GLIM was this kind of metapopulation model, but of course this can be done with all the level of models. So essentially, this is a kind of global model that tries to get only the basic information, let's say, into play. But of course, you can get more complicated models like agent-based models that I was showing you, and they will work much better if the more information, the real information you can get. Okay, because in the other cases, if you do assumptions, you can get some relatively reasonable results, but you will always have the uncertainty, and sometimes it can be uncontrolled. Okay, so this was done with a lot of people, actually much more than in here. I mean, these are just the ones that were consistently working on this for those years, and these are some of the papers, but there were even more, and of course this thing continues all the time, so it's still working, like the Zika examples that I showed you before. Okay, so well, that was it. Thank you very much for your attention.